graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Space Team Universe 5, The Guns of Nana Joan, by Barry J. Hutchison. Narrated by Phil Thron and performed by a full cast.
Commander Junta of the Symmorium stood on the secondary bridge of his Thresher battleship, staring down the approaching Zertex fighter. In the 4 years he had spent in command of the ship, this was only the third time he had ever set foot on the secondary bridge. The first had been during his induction tour. The second time, he'd been playing hide-and-seek with his daughter, Tira. His daughter, Tira, who had been sucked into the vacuum of space along with most of his crew when the primary bridge had exploded. The shark-like Symmorium, with their tough gray hide and dark glassy eyes, were a warrior race first and foremost. Junta was ready for death. He had always been ready for death, both his own and that of his crew. But not her. Not his little girl. Still, he would join her soon enough.
What do we have?
The first Zertek attack ship was joined by another. The two of them had struck out of nowhere, ignored all attempts to hail them, and rejected Junta's attempts to surrender. On the deck behind him, Assistant Communications Officer Glorian, the only remaining crew member, rummaged in a spaghetti of sparking wires, trying to restore power to shields or weapons or comms or anything useful. There was no urgency to her attempts, though. Why rush a lost cause? She hadn't had the heart to tell the commander that she had absolutely no idea what she was supposed to be doing with the wires. On a normal day, her job largely involved her pressing one of three clearly marked buttons and very occasionally speaking into a microphone. Rerouting power through a damaged secondary systems console didn't even fall within spitting distance of her skill set, but the commander had asked so nicely that she'd felt compelled to give it a go. She spliced two wires together just in case. A tiny puff of smoke that somehow managed to make the whole situation feel just a tiny bit more depressing than it already was.
We have nothing, Commander.
The commander nodded, as if this had only confirmed what he already knew. He folded his hands neatly behind his back, puffed out his chest, and watched the Zertex ship's weapons flash.
Please.
The distant glow of two incoming torpedoes reflected in his glassy eyes.
Call me Junta.
Glorian stood. She wanted to salute, but her hands were shaking too badly. She wanted to say something noble and memorable, something befitting the situation, but her words betrayed her.
I am afraid.
The torpedoes streaked across open space, closing fast. Any moment now. Any moment.
Between you and I, Glorian. Me too.
From nowhere, the dark hull of a ship banked up between the Thresher and the torpedoes. Its shields flared as the energy projectiles hammered into it, and then the ship was gone, streaking upwards into a spinning climb. Glorian's jaw dropped, revealing all her many teeth.
Who was that?
Junta stepped closer to the viewscreen and ducked, peering up at the mystery ship as it looped and launched itself towards the Zertex ships on an intercept course.
I do not know, but whoever they are, I hope they know what they are doing.
Cal Carver flailed around in his chair, his face buried in a paper bag that was filling at quite an alarming rate with vomit. The short, sudden burst of light speed, followed by some funking insane maneuvering and the jarring impact of two photon torpedoes, had played havoc with his inner ear, and his digestive system was currently paying a pretty hefty price.
Incoming transmission from Zertex fighters. How should I respond?
Cal lifted his eyes to roughly where he guessed the voice of the ship's artificial intelligence. K70-93307-Zeta, or Kevin, if time wasn't on your side, was coming from.
Tell them to...
He buried his face in the bag.
I see. Very good, sir. How are you spelling that, in case anyone should ask?
Tell them to go funk themselves.
Mech stood before the ship's large view screen, his metal fingers darting across a touchscreen panel below it.
In fact, don't bother. I'll tell them myself.
He stepped back from the screen, made a hand gesture which Cal interpreted as something quite rude, then held the pose until the screen flashed and clicked.
They're firing cannons. Hold on.
Lauren leaned left in the pilot seat and threw her weight onto the controls. The ship rolled into a tight corkscrew spin as crackling red energy beams scorched the void around them.
Oh, Jesus, why do you always do this to me?
Mazed, any response from the Symmorium?
Lauren slammed the right stick and pulled out of the spiral. Slouched in her chair, Miz picked a piece of lint from her fur, rolled it between two claws, then flicked it away before shrugging her broad shoulders.
How should I know?
The ship dropped into a plunging dive, and Cal briefly remembered how much he'd always hated roller coasters before everything suddenly banked upwards again, compacting his testicles against the seat.
Because you're supposed to be trying to hail them!
Well, no one told me.
Yes, we did.
Lauren pushed, pulled, and twisted the controls, sending the ship into a sequence of moves Cal couldn't even begin to describe and never wanted to experience again. The stars and ships on the viewscreen tilted and lurched. His stomach flipped and jiggled. His testicles, for their part, didn't do very much. Although, to be honest, after that last maneuver, he'd be surprised if they ever did anything noteworthy again. As Cal heaved the last of his stomach contents into the bag, it occurred to him that it had, all things considered, been a pretty rough day. Or, not day, exactly, because they didn't have days in space, so Mech kept telling him anyway. A pretty rough day-length period of time, then. He had started it dressed as a lizard and ended it battling a city-sized spider that breathed fire. Many, many things had gone wrong between those two events, the most notable of which being his own violent death. It hadn't been all bad, of course. He'd discovered they had a machine on board that made banoffee pie, albeit after it literally tortured the recipe out of him, and the crew had all earned a share in a 2 million credit fortune. He was also no longer dead, which was a bonus. But then, just as they'd been setting off across the nebula to escape the brewing Zertex versus Symmorium war, they'd picked up Junta's distress call. Much as they were all against the idea of getting dragged into a galaxy-shaking punch-up, Cal had been even more against the idea of leaving Commander Junta to die. Since then, his empty, quivering stomach and pancaked testicles had both given him pause to reconsider, but he was still reasonably confident they were doing the right thing.
Fine, I've called them on the comm thing or whatever.
Mazet scowled, mostly at Lauren, but partly at the universe in general.
Happy now?
Have they answered?
Miz sat a little more upright in her seat.
Doesn't look like it. Want me to try them again?
Do it!
Man, I love it when you take charge.
She turned her attention to the control panel beside her.
A scan of the Symmorium Thresher suggests a reply is unlikely to be incoming anytime soon. All systems are down. Only minimal life support is in place. And if I may be so bold, their kitchen is a bloody shambles.
How many alive?
Lauren flipped the ship upside down as a barrage of cannon fire ripped past.
80.
Cal looked up from his sack of sick.
80?
No, wait. 2. Sorry, I was thinking of something else. Oh.
Oh? What? What's O?
Incoming transmission, sir. Relayed via one of the Zertex fighters. It's from the President.
Sinclair? Shiz. I hoped we could just duck in and out of this without anyone noticing.
He looked to the others for guidance.
Any suggestions? Did we talk to him?
No.
Lauren considered it for a moment.
No.
Cal turned his chair to look at Mazet. She shrugged petulantly.
Whatever, how should I know?
Yeah, probably best if we don't answer it, Kevin.
The tanned, square-jawed face of President Heil Sinclair filled one-third of the screen.
Oh, you already did.
My apologies, sir. I don't know what came over me.
Mr. Carver, fancy seeing you here.
Heil Sinclair. Always a pleasure. Except, you know, when it isn't, which is always because you're a mass-murdering psychopath. So, have you been?
Better than you, it seems.
Sinclair's gaze flitted down to the bag clutched in Cal's lap.
Space travel still not agreeing with you.
Cal rolled the top of the bag closed.
What? This? This is just onions.
On screen, Sinclair blinked.
Sorry.
Cal had no idea what had possessed him to say the bag contained onions. It very clearly did not contain onions. A thick, lumpy onion puree, perhaps, but not onions in their native, regular form. Still, on the upside, Cal was almost certainly the only person involved in the conversation who had any idea what the funk an onion actually was, so he reckoned he could bluff it.
Onions.
He gave the bag a shake, as if that somehow confirmed everything, then set it on the floor beside his chair.
Now, sorry, we're pretty busy here. What was it you wanted?
Short term, I want you to withdraw from this encounter and allow my fighters to continue their engagement with the Symmorium Thresher. Longer term, I want to have your head on a spike and use your hands as back scratchers.
Sinclair shrugged.
But let's focus on the immediate issue for now.
He leaned closer to the camera, so his face filled the whole right third of the view screen. The movement cast most of his features into shadow, but his eyes seemed to blaze in the darkness.
You have intervened in an officially sanctioned wartime confrontation between Zertex and its enemy. Failure to withdraw immediately will only serve to draw you deeper into the conflict and result in a redoubling of my efforts to detain you, torture you, then kill you.
He leaned back.
You don't want to get involved in this, Mr. Carver. Trust me.
Cal drummed his fingers on his armrest, staring blankly into space. When he realized Sinclair had stopped talking, his eyes widened and he sat up straight.
Sorry, were you talking to me? I was miles away thinking about how awesome this ship is that we stole off you. You were saying something about back scratchers?
Sinclair's smile dropped away, revealing the true expression behind it. He opened his mouth to speak, but Cal reacted before the president could utter another word.
Mech, mute this shiznod.
Done.
Sinclair ranted for a few seconds before realizing what had happened. Cal returned the president's smile from earlier, plus interest.
See, the thing is, Heil, we're already involved in this. Since you used footage from our ship to set up the Symmorium and justify going to war with them. We know what really happened. You blew up that moon, not them, and you used us to do it. So unless you want us to tell everyone exactly what you've been up to, I'm going to have to ask you to back off.
On screen, Sinclair laughed in complete silence. It went on for quite a long time. Cal signaled for Mech to cut the mic feed from their ship.
Oh, guess he doesn't believe us.
Oh, he believes us. He just knows no one will listen. Who's going to take the word of a group of on-the-run criminals over the galactic government?
Cal thought for a moment.
Crazy conspiracy theorists?
Great! And that helps us how exactly?
Incoming torpedoes.
Son of a bitch!
Cal gave Sinclair the finger, then the feed snapped off, clearing the right side of the view screen in time for everyone to see an explosive ball of energy hurtling towards them.
Brace!
Cal gripped his armrests as the torpedo detonated against the ship's shields, rattling his skeleton and making his bag of barf jiggle dangerously on the floor beside him. A second torpedo struck somewhere off-screen, and the lights aboard the currently untitled flickered.
I mean, did you even try to dodge those?
They appear to be readying more torpedoes, sir. Would you like me to retaliate?
What's the alternative?
We get blown to bits.
Then, yes, retaliate. Do that one. Jesus, why do you even have to ask? Fire torpedoes!
Missiles, sir. We don't have torpedoes, we have missiles.
Oh, whatever. Just fucking do it.
Very good, sir.
There was a moment of silence, followed by two blinding flashes at either edge of the screen.
All done, sir.
What? That's it? You blew them up?
Indeed.
They ain't showing on the scanners. Looks like they're dust.
Oh.
Cal shifted in his chair.
I mean, where's the fun in that? When I did the guns, it was far more seat-of-your-pants, high-adrenaline, funk, we're probably all going to die space adventure. Now? Boom, done. I miss the old days.
I could deliberately miss next time, if you like, sir.
Cal considered this.
No, it's not the same. Well, I mean, maybe just once. Anyway, Lauren, bring us in close to the Symmorium ship.
Without crashing into it?
Ideally, yes, without crashing into it. I can't wait to see the look on Hunter's big shark face.
Cal stood outside the airlock door, waving at the two Symmorium through the little porthole window. The smaller of the two, the one who wasn't Commander Hunter, waved back until Hunter shot her a sideways look and she snapped her arm down to her side.
There he is.
The inner airlock door slid aside and Hunter stepped through. He wasn't much taller than Cal, but his width, mannerisms, and the fact he was essentially a man-shaped walking shark all made it very clear which of them would emerge victorious from a fight. Fortunately, Cal had no intention of fighting.
Come here, you!
He stepped in and gave Hunter a hug. The Symmorium reacted by not reacting at all. He simply stood, looking impatient, until the ordeal was over. Cal pulled away and beckoned the other Symmorium over.
I don't think you're getting away either, mister.
Miss?
Wow. Seriously? I mean, get in here, you!
He hugged her. To everyone's surprise, but mostly her own, she hugged him back.
Welcome to the currently untitled, our brand new, state-of-the-art experimental prototype ship. Please don't touch anything, because we don't know what 90% of this stuff does, and there's a good chance you'll kill us all.
Hunter lowered his head in a bow of respect.
We appreciate your intervention. Without it, we would surely now both be dead.
Hey, anytime. We were in the neighborhood. What are friends for, right?
Hunter's shiny black eyes became dull, as if a cloud had passed behind them.
If only you had arrived a few moments earlier. Perhaps you would have been in time to save my crew. My daughter.
Your daughter? You mean angry testicles headbutt girl? Oh, yeah.
Cal tapped a button on the door directly across the corridor. It slid aside, revealing the kitchen area. 9 Symmorium stood by the food replicator machine, sniffing curiously at plates of banoffee pie.
About that.
Tira looked up from her plate. Her already wide eyes almost doubled in size. Then she raced for Hunta's arms as he threw them open. Father and daughter collided, squashing the banana-based dessert between them as they hugged and rubbed their snouts together.
Wow, that was a waste of perfectly good pie.
He watched a tear roll down the side of Hunta's face.
I guess I can let it go just this one time.
The currently untitled hadn't been able to save Hunta's whole crew, but they'd put a sizable dent in the death count, at least. Hunta had greeted them all with considerably more stoicism than he had his daughter, but his relief at discovering they were alive, and their own relief at being alive, was as palpable as the aroma of toffee and banana that hung in the air. Cal sat at the long kitchen table, digging into his third slab of pie with a homemade spoon. He was quite proud of the spoon, having fashioned it himself using a piece of scrap metal, a lot of brute force, and several minutes of creative swearing. Admittedly, it had turned out that the piece of metal wasn't actually scrap and was, in fact, quite an important part of the life support systems. But other than a somewhat alarming period of asphyxiation, there had been no real harm done.
Seriously, I can't believe you guys don't like this.
Cal felt like he'd been chewing for quite some time now, and his jaw was feeling the burn. Still, there were four more pies on the table, and he was damned if they were going to go to waste. Some of the Symmorium crew had gone off to explore the ship or to use the comm system to update the folks back home about their run-in with Zertex. Only Junta, Tira, and Glorian had remained in the kitchen. They all watched in growing disbelief as Cal pushed aside an empty plate, thumped the heel of his hand against his chest a couple of times, then reached for the next slice of pie. They had been joined by Splurt, the shape-shifting green blob, who, despite lacking the ability to speak or utter a sound, Cal now considered to be one of his best friends ever. Possibly the best, and certainly the most useful. Whether saving Cal from torture, killing a lot of bad guys in quick succession, or just generally looking funking adorable, Splurt was Cal's go-to ball of goo every time. Splurt sat on the bench beside Cal, only his two bulbous eyeballs visible above the edge of the table as he watched the Symmorium in silence. Tira watched Cal shovel another spoonful of caramel into his mouth.
You have the eating habits of a gur slug, and a juvenile at that.
Tira!
Cal held up a hand.
It's fine. It's fine. Seriously. Kids, right? I mean, I don't even know what a gerslug is, so I'm just gonna go ahead and assume it's something nice. In my head, I'm picturing a baby panda, but with those, like, what are those things bugs have on their heads? Like fuzzy antenna? You know, like pom-poms on little jiggly bits of wire? I'm picturing a baby panda rocking a couple of those, only purple.
It is a parasite of the anus.
Oh. Well, I don't see how that would fit up there at all.
You would not notice a gerslug enter. It would slip in while you slept. You would not become aware until its first acid emission.
Cal froze with the next piece of pie halfway to his mouth. He shifted on the bench.
Jesus.
He continued eating the pie.
Perhaps you have one inside you even now.
Cal put down his spoon.
Look, I'm sorry I punched you in the face and made you cry last time.
I didn't cry.
Well, okay. Then I'm sorry I made droplets of salty water come from your eyes then. Is that better? To be fair, you had very recently headbutted me in the balls and then almost broke my neck, so even though I felt bad about it at the time...
He shot Junta a wary glance.
And you know, obviously still do. You kind of had it coming.
I have trained harder. I would best you now.
Cal shot her a patronizing smile.
Well, I've been given a wizard's magical life force, so no, you wouldn't. I mean, he wasn't really a wizard exactly, but the point still...
Tira lunged across the table. The next thing Cal knew, the tabletop was coming up fast. He barely managed to push the pie to safety before his face slammed into the metal. He grabbed for the wrist of the hand holding him, but her other hand caught three of his fingers and somehow managed to twist them all in opposite directions.
Yield!
Cal raised the middle finger of his free hand. The girl's teeth clamped around it, not tight enough to hurt, but tight enough to certainly imply that pain was a looming possibility.
Okay, yes, tap out. You got me, uncle.
Tira, that's enough. Let him go.
Her various grips were released. She smirked across the table at Cal as she lowered herself back onto the bench. Cal flexed his fingers and rubbed his forehead where it had met the tabletop. He shot Splurt an accusatory look.
So you just sat there and watched that, huh? You didn't think to intervene at all? I'm very disappointed.
Splurt sunk lower on the bench.
But I still love you.
Splurt straightened again. Cal turned to Tira.
Why do you always want to fight me anyway? What have I ever done to you? Apart from punch you in the face, I mean, which, as we've already established, you totally had coming.
It is probably just your face.
Glorian wilted a little as everyone turned to look at her.
Or your personality. I just mean, I'm sure it's nothing personal.
Oh, well, that's okay then.
Cal stood up.
Now, if you'll all excuse me, I think I'll just pop next door and kill myself.
We do appreciate it.
What, me killing myself? Jesus, what is wrong with you people? I mean, you try to help someone.
Your intervention. We appreciate you getting involved in the conflict. The Symmorium owe you a second great debt.
Oh, right. Yeah, well, you know, not a problem. Just happy to help.
Your ship and your crew will be useful additions to our fleet.
Cal began to nod, then stopped.
Yeah, about that. This was a one-time deal. We saw you in trouble and decided to pitch in. We'll take you home, but then we're out of here. We all had a chat about it, and turns out intergalactic war, not really our thing.
So you are a coward, as well as an imbecile.
Jesus, what is with her?
Cal held a hand up to Glorian.
And please don't say my personality and my face. Believe it or not, that doesn't actually make me feel much better.
Your smell then, perhaps?
What? I don't. Okay, maybe a little, but it has been a long day. You ever heard of the spider dragon of Saktar? No? Well, I suggest you look it up. Splurt.
Splurt twanged quietly as he hopped onto Cal's shoulder and draped himself around his neck.
Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to take a shower.
20 minutes later, Cal stood in the shower, enjoying the heat blasting from its many nozzles. It was, hands down, the best shower he'd ever set foot in. It had all kinds of built-in bells and whistles, from ultraviolet pulse lighting to a streaming music service. The joy of the shower wasn't in its extras, but rather in the basics. Somehow, the shower knew exactly how hot he wanted it to be, what pressure he enjoyed, and precisely which crevices to aim for at any given time. The thing knew him better than he knew himself, and he'd spend his entire time in there alternating between getting clean and just giggling happily as another cascade of perfectly targeted heat washed over him. More than even that, though, the shower was his own personal escape pod. It was the one place on the ship that he could be alone and undisturbed. At least now that he and Miz had had that conversation about privacy and the purpose of door locks. It was a sanctuary, a haven, his fortress of solitude.
You missed a spot, sir.
Cal slipped and fell. His bare-ass cheeks slapped against the wet floor.
Jesus fucking Christ, Kevin, what are you doing in here?
I'm always in here, sir.
Cal sprackled himself into a standing position, trying, but not succeeding, to retain some semblance of dignity while doing so. He cupped his hands over his crotch.
What? What do you mean you're always in here? Not always, surely. I mean, you're not here when I'm...
I am, sir.
And what about when I'm...
Alas, sir, yes.
Oh, boy. From now on, you're not allowed in here, okay?
Oh, thank you, sir. Before I take my leave, however, I have been asked to pass on a message from Ms. Lauren. We are approaching the Symmorium's requested destination. We should be arriving any moment.
The ship lurched, slamming Cal face first against the shower glass.
Now.
Christ.
Cal rubbed his tongue across his bottom lip to test for blood.
Kevin, can you please handle landings from now on? And maybe takeoffs?
She won't let me, sir. I've asked, believe me.
Fine, but next time, can you at least give me a little warning when we're going to...
Cal flew backwards against the opposite wall of the shower, jamming the control knobs into his back.
Look out, sir.
Ow, funk! Little late there, Kevin. What now? Should I brace myself? Is it going to happen again?
We have now successfully alighted on the Symmorium landing bay deck, sir. I suspect even Ms. Lauren would have difficulty hitting anything now. However, I can't guarantee it.
Cal rolled his shoulders, fletching his aching back. The water felt good against it.
Oh, okay, tell them I'll be 5 minutes. And get out of here. I'm going to... you know.
Very good, sir. Enjoy.
Oh, I will.
Cal waited for a reply, but none came.
Kevin?
Cal smiled.
Alone at last.
And then... safe in the knowledge that no one was watching, he began to sing. Cal strode down the ramp, his hair still damp, the greatest hits of the Bee Gees still replaying in his head. Lauren, Mech, Miz, and Splurt all waited for him, alongside Junta and two other Symmorium soldiers Cal didn't recognize. Or didn't recognize beyond, hey, you guys all look like walking sharks, at least. All of them, with the exception of Splurt, looked to be varying levels of annoyed at him. He smiled, hoping it would offset their irritation, but fully aware it would likely only make things worse.
What kept you, man? We've been waiting here for like 40 fucking minutes.
Oh, now, Mech. I think we both know that's a bit of an exaggeration, don't we?
It isn't. I make it 42.
Cal pointed to her and winked.
Meaning of life.
Huh?
Doesn't matter. I was in the shower.
He glanced at Mizette, fully expecting some kind of lewd comment, but was both relieved and a little disappointed when none came. She seemed to be watching Mech instead and barely paying him any attention at all. Ever since her and Mech's spider-slaying team-up, Miz's lustful fascination with Cal had shifted its focus to the cyborg instead. And that suited Cal fine. Honestly, it was a weight off his shoulders, no doubt about it. He could walk past her in the ship without fear of molestation, and could turn around in his chair without knowing he'd find her staring at him, her tongue hanging out like a dog on a hot day. And yet...
Nice place you have here, Hunter.
The landing bay looked like pretty much any other landing bay Cal had been on. He supposed they all performed the same function, and there was little point in trying to make them all different just for the sake of it, but a little bit of variation would have been nice. Metal walls? Check. Metal floor? Check. Metal everything else? Check. It had the same enormously high ceiling, the same rows of clinically fluorescent lighting, the same shimmering energy wall through which things could fly, while air and gravity and all that stuff were miraculously kept inside. The currently untitled was one of six spacecraft parked in the landing bay. Cal had no idea what the other ships were, but their appearances ranged from sleek and nimble to... This is the last thing you will ever see. The most aggressive-looking ships had a pointy teeth pattern painted on the side, giving them a shark-like appearance that matched that of their crew. When Cal had first seen the design on Junta's ship, he'd assumed that meant the Symmorium were the bad guys. It felt like the sort of thing the bad guys would do, he reasoned, like the Nazis with their little skullcap emblems. But, as Cal discovered, you couldn't judge a species by the terrifying shark's head motif on their spaceship. Although he remained confident, his views on the Nazis were pretty much bang on. Junta nodded, or maybe bowed. He was kind of lacking in the neck department, or more accurately, overabundant in the neck department to the point he appeared to move seamlessly from head to shoulders, and it made it difficult to tell.
Subsent Toctel requests your presence. He wishes to thank you personally for your intervention.
What? No, it's fine. Seriously, he doesn't need to thank us.
He has ordered the kitchens to prepare a feast.
Oh. Well, in that case.
He looked across to Mech. The cyborg shook his head just a fraction. Lauren looked much more open to the idea, while Miz hadn't been paying enough attention to have formed an opinion. Splurt was hard to judge. The little guy was keeping his cards close to his chest. Also, he had no facial features, and his body language largely involved various types of shuddering, so he wasn't easy to read at the best of times. Cal shrugged.
Sure, why not?
To many people, a race of spacefaring warrior shark monsters might sound nightmarish. And Cal had been fairly alarmed when he'd seen them for the first time himself. He'd recovered quickly, though, and discovered that despite outward appearances, and with the occasional child-sized exception, they were a pretty decent bunch. Cal reckoned, though, that Subsent Tocta would give even other warrior shark monsters nightmares. He wouldn't have been surprised if the high-ranking military leader was the Symmorium's cultural equivalent of the boogeyman. He could imagine generations of terrified Symmorium children desperately trying to get to sleep before Takhta came to take them away. If the rest of the species were sharks, this guy was a prehistoric megalodon. Punta and his crew were powerfully built, but just a little taller than Cal. Takhta, on the other hand, stood a full head taller than Mech, and what a head it was. He had the same pointed snub nose as the others, but his was a history lesson of old scar tissue detailing every conflict he'd ever been involved in. A chunk of flesh had been removed, presumably not on purpose, although Cal wasn't ruling it out, from the right side of his mouth. The result was that several dozen teeth were always on display, as if he had a sneer permanently etched on his face. While all Symmorium had dark, glassy eyes, his were somehow darker still, like two tiny black holes on either side of his head that might suck you in at any moment and never let you go. His uniform was both splendid and immaculate. It was a carefully tailored fit, and he wore it well, badges and all. Despite that, he still looked utterly ridiculous, like a grizzly bear in a three-piece suit. This was not a creature designed to wear clothing. This was not a creature designed to do anything but fight and kill and, well, probably just those two, actually. The underside of his terrifyingly huge bottom jaw was ridged with hundreds of black cone-like spikes. Cal couldn't imagine what purpose they possibly served, beyond to make him look even more intimidating than he already was. A few of the spikes were missing, their places taken by some tooth-shaped scarring that suggested something had tried unsuccessfully to bite Takhta's throat out. Cal imagined the cost for failing in that particular endeavor would have been a pretty steep one, and if that was the damage Takhta was left with, he'd hate to see the other guy. Or, more likely, the bits of him that were left. The stoic and reserved Hunta was a shark thing of few words, but Takhta made him seem positively bubbly by comparison. He sat at the head of the dining room, Cal assumed, although it felt more like a school classroom. Takhta sat behind a table at the front of the room, while everyone else sat behind smaller individual tables facing him. Cal had to fight the urge to raise his hand whenever he wanted to speak. The feast wasn't quite what Cal had been expecting. He'd imagined a table groaning with food, probably fish of some kind, although he didn't say that out loud in case it was racist. Instead, a single plate of something grim and gray was deposited unceremoniously on the tables in front of everyone, along with something that was either some kind of cutlery or a bricklayer's trowel. He suspected it was probably the latter because the stuff on the plate more closely resembled some sort of grouting than it did actual food.
Please, eat.
Takhta eyeballed them all in turn. Cal looked around at the others. Miz was giving the plate an inquisitive sniff, while Lauren just stared blankly at it, as if waiting for it to do something interesting. Mech had raised a trowel full of the stuff to his mouth and was tentatively tasting it. He briefly recoiled in horror, smacked his fleshy top lip against his metal bottom one, then shrugged and carried on eating. Splurt's plate was already empty. Cal could see the entire gray lump just sitting inside the little blob's semi-transparent body right below his eyes. It did not make the heaped helping on his own plate look any more appetizing. Hunta and the two other soldiers stood at the back of the room. None of them were eating. They were, Cal couldn't help but notice, standing in front of the door, but he tried not to read too much into that.
What do you call this?
Cal scooped up some of the mush. It quivered slightly on the trowel as he raised it to his mouth.
Pluck. It is dense in nutrients.
Which is what you want from a feast, isn't it? All this messing around with, you know, roast pigs and apples in the mouth or whatever. Forget the decadence, I say. Give me density of nutrients.
He deposited the slop into his mouth.
Jesus.
Cal chewed as fast as he could. Technically, it wasn't really chewing, because that implied some sort of resistance. Instead, it basically involved rolling the stuff around inside his mouth until such times as he could work up the courage to swallow it.
Yum. That is good plock. You really must give me the recipe.
The Symmorium is grateful for your assistance against the Zertex forces. Many lives would have been lost had you not intervened.
No problem. Right, guys?
Lauren tore her eyes away from the plock.
Yes. Yes, it was our pleasure.
Takta's hollow-eyed gaze shifted across to Lauren.
It must have been difficult for you. You are of Zertex stock, yes?
If you mean did I used to work for Zertex, then yes. But I saw them for what they are, and there's no love lost between us now.
But you have kin with them.
Lauren shifted in her seat.
Brothers, yes.
Takta said nothing, but held his gaze on her until she felt compelled to continue talking.
Two of them. So what? I mean, why? I mean, that's got nothing to do with anything.
Takta's stare continued to bore into her for several seconds, but Lauren resisted the urge to try to fill the conversational void. Eventually, the Symmorium nodded, as if the silence itself had answered some unasked question. He turned his attention back to Cal.
We would appreciate your assistance in the conflict. I believe your ship would be of use to us.
Cal shot Mac a sideways glance. There was that shake of the head again.
Yeah, we get that. We really do. It's just, well, we don't want to get any more involved than we already are, you know?
He jabbed a thumb back towards Junta.
I mean, if we see some of you guys in trouble, you know, like being blown up or whatever, we'll absolutely try to help out. It's just the whole getting caught up in a full-scale war thing. It's not really something we're into, but, you know, thanks for the offer and everything.
The temperature in the room seemed to drop several degrees as Takta leaned forwards in his chair.
Zertex is claiming we destroyed Pickish. It was your vessel that caused the destruction of the moon and the death of all those on it.
But we didn't pull the trigger. Zertex did.
Then you should help us fight them. They betrayed you. They used you to strike at us.
Oh, we know. And believe me, those guys are off our Christmas card list forever. But we won't get involved in your war. I'm sorry, that's just the way it is.
Cal did his best to hold the giant Symmorium's stare. He found himself gripping the table as if it was the only way to resist being dragged into that black hole gaze.
We could make you help us through force.
You are welcome to try.
For a long time, nobody moved or said a word. Finally, Takta pushed back his chair and raised himself up to his full towering height. His teeth ground together as he chewed over his next few words.
The Symmorium thanks you for your assistance today. Now kindly leave. Some of us have a war to fight.
One, you're welcome. Two, good luck with that. We're all rooting for you guys all the way. And three...
He pointed down to the sloppy gray mush on his plate.
I don't suppose you have a doggy bag for this? I think I broke a bathroom tile earlier, and this would be perfect for sticking it back together.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.